Good evening. My name is Alan
Jorgensen, Assistant Dean at Martin Luther University College, and I'm so very glad to welcome you all to this 12th annual Circle of Dialogue entitled A Wampum Belt Presentation, The Friendship Belt, sponsored by Martin Luther University College and the Center for Public Ethics. We're especially pleased to welcome our presenter, Yvonne Bomberry, Associate Professional Faculty, Teaching Indigenous Wisdom and Methodologies at Luther, will be properly introduced shortly. As we begin tonight, we acknowledge that we are gathered on the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, Anishinaabe, and Neutral peoples. We meet here on the Haldimand Tract, which secured 6 miles on each side of the Grand River from Lake Erie to its head for the Haudenosaunee people for their enjoyment forever as compensation for their service to the Crown and for lands lost during the American Revolution. This territory is part of the Dish With One Spoon Treaty, commending all to live in peace, stewarding and sharing the resources of this land, home now to people from other First Nations, Métis, and Inuit communities. We give thanks to the First People for their care of the land and commit ourselves to being at peace and unity with them in this sacred work. We join together today, seeking friendship and good minds that can discern how we can polish the silver covenant chain that binds us to the people of this land and so to this land to whom we offer our deep gratitude. In this season of our first mother's resting, we too dare to dream of and work for a world where treaties are upheld, where justice flows freely, and where every path is paved with peace. Tonight, we'll see two videos followed by a question and answer, which will not be recorded. I now invite my colleague, Mona Tukerik-Lafosse, to introduce our speaker.
Well, hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us. Thanks, Alan. My name is Mona Tukerik-Lafosse. I'm an assistant professor at Luther, and I'm very pleased to be one of the organizers of the Circle of Dialogue, along with Alan. And I am also very happy to introduce one of our newest colleagues at Luther, Yvonne Bomberry. So Yvonne is currently a PhD candidate in the social work program at Memorial University in Newfoundland. She received a Master of Social Work degree from McMaster University in 2000 and a Bachelor of Social Work degree from the University of Calgary in 1997. She has taught at universities, a number of universities, including Wilfrid Laurier University. Her research focuses on Haudenosaunee women and lateral violence. She has practiced social work in her home community of Six Nations of the Grand River Reserve, and she is currently employed in her neighboring community of Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation. And Yvonne also is currently, as Alan pointed out, an associate professional faculty member here at Luther, and we're very pleased that she teaches our graduate course entitled Indigenous Wisdom and Methodologies. By way of introduction to Yvonne's lecture, we will begin with a short clip on traditional wampum belts, and it is an excerpt from a 2018 PBS series called Native America. It's produced by Providence Pictures with generous support from the Anne Ray Foundation and the CBP. And following that clip, we will have Yvonne's lecture and then our question and answer time. So please enjoy.
Marcus Hendricks makes wampum beads. He is a member of the Mashpee Wampanoag. The Haudenosaunee acquired wampum beads from his people and other Atlantic coastal communities.
Wampanoag means people of the first light, people of the dawn. They witnessed the first horizon of the sun coming up.
The first step to making wampum is gathering shellfish in his ancestral waters off Cape Cod.
When I come out onto the water, there's a connection to my ancestors, a relationship that goes through my blood and my veins.
The shells of quahog are the raw material for wampum.
Mm-hmm. You want to look for a good thickness in a quahog.
The fire is both the first step in a gratitude offering and prepares the quahog to be opened.
I was taught really young to take the time to give thanks and say a few prayers to the Creator. We do that anytime we're harvesting anything from Mother Earth.
Marcus uses traditional methods to transform the shell into wampum beads, refining raw shell until it can be strung together into a wampum belt.
Each bead took a lot of hours and a lot of manpower. Each strand probably would have taken a year to make.
When strung into a belt, wampum empowers the person holding it as a representative of their people.
They were made for ceremonies to depict stories and treaties between tribes. So if I was to go visit another nation, I would bring the belt to show that there's a close bond between the nations.
Sego, Sewaguego. Hello, everybody. My name is Yvonne Bomberry, and I am Haudenosaunee from the Six Nations Reserve. I am Mohawk and Bear Clan, and I'm going to speak to you a bit about wampum belts, more specifically, the friendship belt. I just want to say that I am by no means an expert on wampum belts, but I can share what I have learned about them with you. So following this presentation, there'll be a question and answer period. When I began teaching for Luther in the fall, I began my first class with a discussion of two wampum belts. I shared some brief information about the two-row wampum belt and the friendship belt. The students were so interested in the discussion that the class ran overtime. For some or most of the students, this was the first time hearing this information. For other students, they shared their outrage in learning that Canada had legally binding agreements with my people and had not lived up to these obligations. I felt that it gave students a context to hearing about broken treaties and Canada's obligation to First Nations people. So what I have learned is that there are many wampum belts made by my people, the Haudenosaunee. Wampum belts are made from wampum beads. So historically, wampum beads were made from shells. I think it's called quahog shells, and they were purple and white. And what I also found out is there are a specific number of beads for each wampum belt as well. So shell beads were used by many Indigenous nations all over the world, but the wampum belt is specific to North America. They are used for official or ceremonial use. The strings of wampum are used as credentials or as a certificate of authority. So all chiefs and clan mothers of the Haudenosaunee would have their own strings of wampum beads. It is also said that these beads or strings of wampums, they guarantee a message or a promise. So for Haudenosaunee people, wampum belts are historic documents that commemorate significant events. They've been described as living documents, and many of the belts are associated with a treaty that was made with another nation. The belt that I will discuss today is the Friendship Belt, or the Silver Covenant Chain of Peace and Friendship Belt. I have a replica of this belt that I will show as we discuss it, because what I also learned is that there are many different belts, and there's also different friendship belts. So with my people, we also had a friendship belt with the Anishinaabe people. So for this original belt, I'll just show it right here. Hopefully you can see it good. The original, this is, like I said, it's a replica. For the original belt, there's 1900 wampum beads on the belt. 240 are purple, and then the other 1,660 are white beads. This belt was associated with a treaty made with Lieutenant Governor Denny of Pennsylvania on behalf of the Crown. And it was in 1757. So the Covenant Chain Belt represents one of the earliest treaties between the Crown and First Nations people. It established the foundation for First Nations and Crown relationships for generations thereafter. I also discovered in some research that it was called the Governor Denny's Invitation Belt, and it stated that particular article stated that it was from 1758, like a year later. It stated that it was sent to Indigenous people at the time from this governor to ask for aid in fighting with other rival white colonies. So I'll just hold the belt up again. The belt is a symbol of peace and unity. So it shows two figures you can see on each end here. So one figure, it symbolizes the British crown at the time it would be the king over on this side. And the other represents the Haudenosaunee. And it shows that they hold the chain between them. You'll see the long line here between them. That is the chain, and it represents a clear and honest communication between them, as well as an open path of peace that connects the two. It shows that their hands are, they're interlocking, and it signifies that they're thereby making this human chain. So the links on the chain, they represent the covenant of friendship, good minds, and peace, which shall remain between us forever. So the covenant chain is made of silver. And again, I'll just show it again. So the chain is depicted with the long line in between the two figures. So the chain is made of silver. It symbolizes that the relationship will need to be polished from time to time to keep it from tarnishing. So in other words, there needs to be care and attention taken to this chain. And then also the significance of the chain is that chains are strong and they're likely to last and hold up, I guess. I also found another description of this relationship. And according to Haudenosaunee oral history, it states that this relationship will be everlasting for future generations, as the rising faces of our newborn on Mother Earth will benefit. It shall stand as long as the sun shines upon the earth, as long as the waters flow, and as long as the grass grows green. Our relationship shall be binding as long as the Mother Earth is in motion. So this was the basis of nation-to-nation relationship between the British Crown and the First Nations, who became their allies in the formation of early Canada. The relationship and commitment was repeated by the Crown representatives in future dealings with all of First Nations peoples in Canada. And then sadly, we have learned that all of the treaties made were never upheld by the Crown. Canada has not honored their commitments made by these treaties and symbolized through these wampum belts. The relationship is tarnished, and there needs to be care and attention taken in renewing these agreements. This is the first discussion held by Luther about wampum belts, and we hope to continue to do a series of presentations or discussions about wampum belts in the future. Hopefully, when we can gather again in person, we will have an interactive presentation about the two-row wampum belt. There are just so many wampum belts to discuss. And so hopefully the next one we'll learn about is the two-row wampum. I just want to say thank you, Nyawa, for taking the time to learn about wampum belts. I will try to answer any questions that you have. And if I don't know the answer, I can find someone who does know the answer. Thank you.